Good morning, everybody. On behalf of Govind Ramnath Kare College of Law Alumni Association, my pleasure to extend to you a very warm welcome to this panel discussion. As we all know, on 14th August 2020, Honorable Supreme Court of India held social activist and senior advocate Prashant Bhushan guilty of having committed criminal contempt. The judgment has invoked mixed response. The Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa has come in support. Many social activists, some advocates have rallied in support of the right of freedom of speech and expression. The Alumni Association as an association does not have any opinion of its own. Its individual members have diversified opinions. Therefore, at the very start of this debate, to make it clear that the Alumni Association is only having an academic platform where the learned panelists can express their views. The views expressed by our panelists may not be the views of the association or of its members. Therefore, we request all panelists to act with responsibility. With that, may I request the president of G.R. Kare College of Law Alumni Association, Advocate Prasad Naik, to deliver the welcome address. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. On behalf of Govind Ramnath Kare College of Law Alumni Association, it is my pleasure to welcome all panelists and participants to this webinar. We have today amidst us five eminent personalities from the legal field. We have political strategist, former MLA, and a renowned lawyer, Advocate Radharao Gracious. We have a constitutional expert and lecturer in law, an eminent High Court lawyer, Advocate Cleopat Coutinho. We have the former president of South Goa Advocates Association, an activist, an eminent criminal lawyer, Advocate Rajiv Ghose. We have the former president of North Goa Consumer District Forum, Advocate Sanjay Chodankar. And last but not the least, we have the very vocal Advocate Sanjit Desai. I invite all the panelists and throw open the discussion by inviting Advocate Cleopat Coutinho to express his views.
Good morning, everybody. I hope I'm audible.
Yes.
Pritam said that we have to be responsible in our views. Certainly, yes. They are certainly academic also. See, contempt law and contempt jurisdiction is problematic. The judge himself as a prosecutor and a victim. It starts with the presumption of guilt, not innocence. The judge has the discretion to decide punishment and there is no appeal. This is what happens when a matter comes before the Supreme Court in contempt jurisdiction. Lord Denning had said, as we ourselves have interest in the matter, let me say at once, we will never use this jurisdiction as a means to uphold our dignity. That must rest on surer foundations. That is because of the problem I have just said. This contempt law is a hangover from the colonial past. It is not compatible with democratic principles. Most countries which wish to strengthen their democracy has done away with this law. In 1913, Britain did away with this law. The last contempt case that came up in England is in 1931. In Canada, in a case called Copito case, the court said, courts are not fragile flowers that may wither away with controversies. Justice Hugo Block in America said, public opinion cannot be silenced in the presence of contempt of court. In 2010, Justice Krishna Iyer said the best answer to the abuse of judges is not frequent or ferocious contempt sentencing, but fine performance. Now, with this, I will come to the present case. Now, the present case has pointed out two issues. One is that the two tweets, let us analyze them separately, has damaged the dignity and authority of the Supreme Court. Two, malicious attack cannot be permitted. Now, when I said that this is contempt jurisdiction is very problematic because the judge acts as a victim and at the same time prosecutor, and there is no appeal. Let us see how earlier also this has happened. See, in 1964 or so, EMS Namboodiripad had said that our judges have a class bias. He said that they are always in favor of well-dressed, pot-bellied, rich men as against poor, ill-dressed, and illiterate person. He was convicted of contempt by the Kerala High Court. The Supreme Court at that time upheld it. The judge was none other than Justice Hidayatullah, one of our finest judges. Now, in the year 1987, a former judge and a former law minister said that judges have an elitist bias. He said that FERA violators, bride burners, and a whole horde of reactionaries have found their haven in the Supreme Court. Now, there was a contempt case, P.N. Duda versus P. Shivshankar. And the court held that after reading of the entire speech, he is entitled to hold that. And finally, the contempt proceedings were dropped. Now, all that I am trying to say is that almost the same thing, what EMS Namboodiripad said and what Shivshankar said is almost the same thing. And one court convicted, same court let off, because the second court said that we should have broader shoulders. We must not punish people in contempt because they hold a particular view. And finally, we will find the view taken by the court, and that was written by Sabyasachi Mukherjee, who the view that which Justice Canning had taken. Now, the two tweets. CJI writes a 50 lakhs motorcycle belonging to a BJP leader at Raj Bhavan without a mask and a helmet. Now, this part of the tweet is held not to be contemptuous because this is against the judge as an individual. Now, the second part of the same tweet is, at a time when it keeps the Supreme Court in lockdown, denying citizens fundamental rights to access public justice, tendency has a tendency to shake confidence of the public at large and the institution of judiciary. That means the second part of the tweet, which says that the Supreme Court has been kept in lockdown mode and a fact that fundamental rights are denied to citizens, that according to the Supreme Court has a tendency to shake the confidence of the public. The court says that they had 879 sittings, 686 petitions were disposed, and 12,758 matters were heard. Now, because of these hearings, the court says that the tweet is not true and it has a tendency to interfere with the course of justice. Now, the fact is that a fraction of the work has actually been done. In fact, one of the judges of the Supreme Court, who was in the collegium, Justice Madan Lokur, has said that the poor and the marginalized did not get justice during that period. He gives F grade to the Supreme Court. Now, I would say this is a view of Bhushan. There is a view taken by, say, Justice Ajit Shah, Justice Madan Lokur, and so many other eminent personalities have taken that view. Maybe Bhushan was wrong, but should he have been punished or should he be convicted for this tweet is the issue that arises. Now, second part is like this. When historians in future books look back at the last 6 years to see how democracy has been destroyed, even without a formal emergency, now this part of the tweet is held not contemptuous. They will particularly mark the role of Supreme Court in this destruction, and more particularly the role of 4 Supreme Court judges. Now this part is held to be contemptuous. Now the point I say is that this may be wrong, but is he entitled to say that? Is it his opinion? And if it is his opinion, he should not express it, even if it is wrong. And in any case, should we say that what advocates say matters so much that the public faith in the Supreme Court fails, or the faith in the Supreme Court would be strengthened by their judgments, by their orders and conduct of the judges? Now that is what Justice Krishna Iyer had said in a case called Lord Shawcross had said, Denning is an ass, while referring to one of his judgments. This came up before Denning. And Lord Denning said, I disprove it, but I will not use contempt against him, but I will disprove this by performance. We must have heard of the famous Daily Mirror case. After a judgment, the famous judgment where Daily Mirror published the photographs of 3 judges upside down with the caption of "You old fools." This again came up before Justice Templeman, who was one of the judges in that case. And Justice Templeman said that, yes, I am old. I am not a fool. I am wise enough. But if Daily Mirror says that I am a fool, it is their opinion they are entitled to. The House of Lords never said that their work will come down because Daily Mirror so said. In 2016, even after the contempt law was dropped in England, there was this famous case which came up where the Daily Mirror again published the main title, Enemies of the Nation. And the judges were said to be in league with the enemies of UK. It was said that the judges are in league with those people who want UK to remain in the European Union. And there is an unholy alliance. Again, we will find the question was that enemies of the nation was contempt of the court, though such a law does not exist. And the House of Lords decided not even to take cognizance of this matter. So my submission is that 2 submissions. One is, in this Prashant Bhushan case, the Supreme Court has not laid down any law. It has only affirmed the law that has been in force for a long time, the law which says that you are entitled to criticize the judgment, you are entitled to criticism without malice. Now the question lies there. Whether a particular tweet or a particular statement or a particular press note or a particular issue is malicious or not. Now, if in Shiv Shankar's case, likening judges to FERA violators, bribe burners, and people like that was held not contemptuous because our courts are strong enough not to be feathered away by such comments, because justice and judges have broader shoulders. I would say the problem lies there. The problem lies in that discretion which the judges have in holding a particular matter malicious or not. See, we all obey judgments of the Supreme Court. We all obey judgments of the court. It is Ambedkar who successfully argued for contempt of courts before the Constituent Assembly. He was opposed in the Constituent Assembly, but he successfully argued. And when the matter came up before him in Parliament, because in 1951, we have the famous case of Champakam Dorai Rajan, when the reservation policy of the Madras government was struck down, Ambedkar was questioned in Parliament, and what he said was like this. I just want to quote him. He said, "I have often, in the course of my practice, told the presiding judge in very emphatic terms that I am bound to obey his judgment, but not bound to respect it. This is the liberty that every lawyer enjoys in telling the judge that his judgment is wrong, and I am not prepared to give up that liberty." Now, the question that I would say is, once a judgment is given by the Supreme Court, the judgment, whether it is in Prashant Bhushan's case, whether it is in any case, we are bound to obey, because a judgment of the Supreme Court has to be obeyed. But the question is whether the entire legal fraternity, whether the state, whether the country would respect, whether respect is gained by punishing people in contempt for criticizing the Supreme Court, criticizing the judges, or it would be gained by performance. Because I say that respect can never be. Okay.
Yeah.
To conclude, I would say that the jurisdiction itself is problematic, as I said in the beginning. And secondly, nobody questions the power of the Supreme Court. The question is of that exercise of jurisdiction which holds on the same facts somebody liable for criminal contempt, on the same facts another court holds the same person not another person not liable on the same facts, as we have seen in the Shiv Shankar case, where the Supreme Court judges were likened to FERA violators, bribe burners, and persons of that nature. So the court should be on broader shoulders, one. Number two, I would say the court's worth, and the court would get respect by its judgment, by pronouncement of judgments, by its orders, and the conduct of the judges, and not what lawyers say. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Advocate Cleofat. We move on to Advocate Sanjay Chorankar. Sanjay Chorankar, your views, please.
Hello. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Yes. Hello?
Yeah, Sanjay, you can start. You're audible.
Okay. Hello to everybody. See, I will be speaking in support of the Supreme Court judgment. My views. Now, this Prashant Bhushan is one of the topmost lawyer who is practicing in the Supreme Court for the last 30 years. Now, he, along with other lawyers who are also practicing in the Supreme Court, have a habit of making unnecessary comments against the Supreme Court judges. And this happens only when the judgments are given against them. And any public interest litigation is filed by them and the judgment is given against them, then they start making fun of the Supreme Court and even the judges of the Supreme Court. Now, Prashant Bhushan have on various occasions, he is making this type of comments in social media, on TV also, and through the tweets also. Now, as far as these two tweets are concerned, the Supreme Court has taken note of it. Now, the first tweet, which was done by him, that was on 26th June 2020, wherein he said that democracy is destroyed for the last 6 years, especially making a reference to the present BJP rule government. And in which the Supreme Court has supported the government in destruction of the democracy. The second tweet he made was that against CGI, Mr. Bobde. Now, making a fun of the Supreme Court judges in public, and that too by a lawyer who is practicing before the Supreme Court for the last 30 years, according to me, it is not proper. If he had any grievance against the CGI or against the Supreme Court of India for keeping the Supreme Court under lockdown, he should have approached the Supreme Court. He should not have made the fun of the Supreme Court judges and the Supreme Court in public. Now, now after taking into consideration what he has done, the Supreme Court has decided this matter. And under Section 129 of the Indian Constitution, the Supreme Court has clear-cut powers to punish this type of lawyers or people who make fun of Supreme Court and the Supreme Court judges. So therefore, I will say that he should be punished, because if he is not punished, then this type of activities will continue. No oral apology should be accepted from him. He should be sent to the prison, because this is over and over again. He has been repeating this type of activities. That's all. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Sanjay. You have been loud, vocal, and clear enough. Can I move on to the next panelist, Advocate Rajiv Gomes? Advocate Rajiv? Rajiv? Advocate Rajiv looks like he's having some problem.
Yes.
Yeah, Advocate Rajiv, can you start?
Yep. Rajiv? Again, can you hear me?
Yeah, Rajiv, we can hear you.
Hello.
Yes.
You can hear, no? All right.
Yeah.
See, I'm the third speaker today, and out of five. So probably I feel I should not take any sides very clearly. You know, I should take the middle path, and that is what I decided to do. But before I start, I have to express my profound appreciation and gratitude to the G.R. Kare College of Law Alumni Association for having taken such a bold step to organize this panel discussion. the contemptuous nature of which in the present scenario may be pretty unclear. We will come to know later. Yet the discussion on this very important and significant topic, I guess, outweighs the risk involved. See, all of us know that the Supreme Court of India and our judiciary has been held in high esteem. All of us lawyers hold the judiciary in high esteem. The judiciary is considered the last bastion of justice and hope to our people. That is the final. We cannot go beyond that. And everybody conducts their business and their life in a way which shows that they have full faith in the Supreme Court. And it is for this reason that the dignity and the authority of the Supreme Court has to be preserved, protected at all costs, especially by lawyers. But nevertheless, we cannot be oblivious to the fact that the Supreme Court or our judiciary discharges in our democratic setup a public function, a public duty, and which makes it amenable to public scrutiny, and which may lead to fair and bona fide criticism. The power to punish for contempt exists, and in a country like India, I feel it should exist, because there are many, I'm going to comment on these two tweets, but there are many people who, if the contempt power is removed, may completely vanquish the judiciary. So contempt powers are required in a country like us. But at the same time, as held by the Honorable Supreme Court in this judgment itself, fair and bona fide criticism should also be acceptable. Though the Supreme Court in this judgment has held that it has transgressed that limit. Now therefore, the question would be whether these two tweets, which have been tweeted by Advocate Prashant Bhushan, which are based on statements of facts as well as his opinion, on the basis of certain irrefutable occurrences which have occurred in the Supreme Court or probably through his experience and in the discharge of his or in the exercise of his fundamental right to speech and expression, whether these tweets could be said to be fair criticism or not. The Supreme Court has held otherwise, but with all due respect to the Honorable Supreme Court, I beg to differ. I come to the first tweet. The first tweet says the Honorable, I won't come to the tweet as far as the personal allegation is made against the Honorable Chief Justice, but about the second one, that the Honorable Supreme Court was kept in a lockdown mode and fundamental rights were denied to citizens. But coming to the first tweet, is it not true that there was a cessation of physical functioning of the Supreme Court since the outbreak of the pandemic? And what is the meaning of cessation of? It means there is the lockdown, and that is what precisely meant, is that the lockdown mode, the mode, because physical functioning, definitely nobody can deny the fact that it led to citizens having been denied. I'm not saying the vast majority of the citizens, but definitely, as made out in the reply by Prashant Bhushan, habeas corpus petitions and so many other petitions of constitutional value were kept pending because of this absence of physical functioning. So therefore, what I'm trying to say is, the Honorable Supreme Court says that this tweet is false. It is malicious. It is scandalous. I beg to differ, because there is some element of truth. Nobody can say that it's absolutely false. If there is a lockdown, there is a lockdown. Are we going to close our eyes and say there's never been a lockdown because some level of matters have been decided? As my colleague, Advocate Kleopath, has rightly said, it's a fraction. He has quoted some ex-justice. It's a fraction. So therefore, we cannot deny this. So what I'm trying to say is, there is some element of truth. And where is there some element of truth, we would have amount just and bona fide criticism benefit of doubt at this stage, even in a contempt proceeding where a person is being punished, I feel has to be given to the person, to the condemner, to the alleged condemner. It could be a case where there is a probable case that this tweet had some fairness in it, that it could have been prompted by the state of affairs in the Supreme Court. If one goes by the reply, I think it is obvious. As far as the second tweet is concerned, the second tweet said there was a destruction of democracy. I don't want to comment on that because that is not my domain to comment, but it says the Supreme Court has destroyed its, has helped in its destruction, and the role of the last four CJIs would be actually marked by historians. Now, as far as that is concerned, see, first of all, I don't understand. What baffles me is that Honorable Supreme Court, with an august and magnificent body, which has the trust of the entire people of India, could, by two tweets of an individual lawyer, it's not even a body of lawyers, an individual lawyer, two tweets could rattle the Supreme Court. This is something which is absolutely unacceptable. I would not accept the Supreme Court to have reacted this way. The Supreme Court ought not to have reacted this way. It is too small. When an elephant walks, you don't pay heed to dogs barking. That should have been the attitude of the Supreme Court. It should not have paid heed to it. Now, nevertheless, if one goes by the reply, the reply is very clear. Advocate Prashant Bhushan has made certain statements which again create a doubt whether those statements could be valid criticism. Go through the entire judgment of the Honorable Supreme Court. It is obvious that there is absolutely no reasoning or absolutely nothing said about these allegations or submissions made by Advocate Prashant Bhushan. Absolutely nothing. The Honorable Supreme Court has taken into consideration two aspects. One is that issue, it was made by Prashant Bhushan, and as a status of a lawyer and responsible person, he ought not to have made it. And second, that these tweets have a far reach. And these two considerations, on this basis of just these two considerations, the Honorable Supreme Court has concluded that these tweets were not made in good faith. My respectful submission, these two aspects were completely irrelevant. What was relevant to decide whether the criticism was fair, bona fide, and in good faith was whether the tweets made and the supporting evidence which was given by Advocate Prashant Bhushan had some element of fairness in them. Now, it is very, very important to note here that let us ask ourselves, is Advocate Prashant Bhushan the first one to cast this slur on the Supreme Court? My dear friends, it is not. The first slur was cast by the Supreme Court judges itself on the Supreme Court on the 12th or 13th of January 2018, when the four Supreme Court judges said that there is a threat to the integrity of the institution. I'll just read one para from that, the letter which was given to the Chief Justice at that particular time. It is read this way: "It is with great anguish and concern that we have thought it proper to address this letter to you so as to highlight certain judicial orders passed by this court, which has adversely affected the overall functioning of the justice delivery system and the independence of the high courts, besides impacting the administrative functioning of the office of India." They had a press conference. I don't have time now to express everything, but were they held in contempt for making such a statement to the press? No, they were not held in contempt. Why they were not held in contempt? They were not held in contempt because at that particular time, the Supreme Court in its wisdom probably must have thought that this was in the interest of the Supreme Court to strengthen it. This type of criticism was required to strengthen it. It was fair and bona fide, and therefore probably no contempt of court proceedings were launched. Therefore, if another citizen, in all fairness, has certain facts before him which make him to believe or form an opinion that something is amiss, it is his opinion. He may be right or wrong, but can it be said that he has said it in bad faith just because he tweets it out and he's a lawyer? No, it cannot be. The Supreme Court, I feel, my respectful submission is, I feel the Supreme Court ought to have discussed his reply threadbare to find out whether there was truth. The should have, the Honorable Supreme Court should have said that there is no truth in the submissions made by him. That the truth, that the entire affidavit consists of falsity. No such a finding is given by the Honorable Supreme Court. So therefore, petition and the punishment and the holding of Advocate Prashant Bhushan guilty of this. See, I want to make it very clear. This, I don't hold any brief for Advocate Prashant Bhushan, nor do I know him. But it is a matter of principle. See, to reiterate, to summarize, see, our Supreme Court and our judiciary, governments come and governments go, but the judiciary remains constant. So and as lawyers, as stakeholders in the process, as officers of the court, we form, in my opinion, a class apart. We are not like the general citizens. We as lawyers know the intimate functioning of the judiciary, which may be unknown to the others. We are in a better position to speak our minds and form an opinion. And we have to, in the interest of the very institution of the judiciary, I feel a lawyer who makes a fair criticism of any functioning of the judiciary should not be punished. Stifling of a voice of a lawyer who makes fair and bona fide criticism of the functioning of the judiciary is too dangerous to our democracy and the very institution of the judiciary. I feel the Supreme Court, in its magnanimity, should close these proceedings, sit down and think this over. Punishment is not the way forward. The Supreme Court, even the Chief Justice of India at the moment, has a large heart. Some sort of generosity has to be shown in magnanimity has to be shown by the Supreme Court. It cannot be take such harsh stance. That is what I feel. I feel, in fairness, the Supreme Court ought to have decided and discussed the another aspect before I conclude. What about the incident of Chief Justice of India Ranjan Gogoi, when he was accused of sexual harassment by a woman colleague? How many of us who know about this incident do not have a bitter taste in our mouth? How many of us can we deny it, that things did not go the right way? So who is it who has brought the, who is bringing disrepute to the organization, to the institution or the judiciary? I leave it to you to decide that.
Yeah, Rajiv. Thank you, Rajiv. Without wasting any more time, we move on to our next panelist, Advocate Radharao Gracious.
Gracious, sir. Gracious.
A man with all grace.
Dutta, your audio is off.
Sir, you'll have to switch on. Your audio is off. Yeah.
Anyway, the Supreme Court says, in the event of it imposing a sentence on activist Advocate Prashant Bhushan already convicted of contempt of court, the sentence will not be carried out till Bhushan files a plea seeking review of the conviction, and it is decided by the court.
That's news. I think Advocate Radharao.
We'll have to restrict ourselves now only to the conviction.
His voice heard. Can we move on to Advocate Sanjit? And yes, then Advocate Radharao can comment later on. Sanjit, you can start.
Hello, everyone. Can you hear me?
Yeah,
yes,
very much audible. You
can start.
Yeah, very much audible.
Now, I will not go into the aspect.
Hello?
He's come. Okay, let him continue.
Okay, Dodan, start. Yeah, you're audible now.
I can be heard, no? Yeah.
Yeah, you can be heard.
Yes. See, I've been listening to Cleopat.
There appears to be a conspiracy to keep Advocate Radha Rao quiet today.
He conspires.
I think we'll move on to Advocate Sanjit. Sanjit?
No, should I start?
Yeah, you start.
Okay. Now, to start with,
I muted is this thing. So Sanjit, you can start. Sanjit, start.
If the judiciary, if the judiciary has to perform its duties and function effectively, it is essential to protect the dignity and the authority of the court.
So then I've asked Sanjit to start, so you can take 2 or 3 minutes to just... Sanjit, you can start.
Now, there is to give a justification to the tweets. Now, as Mr. Prashant Bhushan is already convicted by the Honorable Supreme Court, according to me, we have to abide by the Supreme Court judgment because there is no appeal provided under the Act, under the Contempt Act. If a person is convicted by the Supreme Court, if it was convicted by the High Court, yes, there is a appeal provided and where a person can appeal to the Supreme Court. So, now, my colleague Rajiv tried to explain the tweets, tried to bifurcate the tweets or saying that the first part is not offensive, second part is offensive. Now, when that tweet is read by a layman, can he bifurcate it? Or as a person, as a layman, will read it as in totality? According to me, that tweet has to be taken in totality. You cannot bifurcate it. When I am reading it as a layman, when a countryman is reading it as a layman, it cannot be taken as it cannot be bifurcated. First tweet was that Supreme Court, 4 of the Supreme Court judges have destroyed, or the Supreme, what he is trying to, can we? He says that Supreme Court is killing the Constitution. Now this tweet or this person of caliber of Prashant Bhushan makes such a tweet, then it has a long-standing effect on the faith of the people who have faith on the Supreme Court. Further, he says the Supreme Court has destroyed the democracy. So, when such a manner tweets are made, can you justify this, saying that this is not an attack on judiciary, this is an attack on personal attack on the judges? We are once you are part of it. You are appearing before the court. You are representing so many people. And still you can say that you are saying that Supreme Court has destroyed democracy. And the same person had tweeted when Justice Karan was convicted of contempt. He has appreciated that Supreme Court. He had tweeted that Supreme Court, finally this person has been sent to the taken into custody. So can we look it into this aspect in a singular manner? Because when Justice Karan was convicted, no one questioned. Not a single voice was raised. So what is the this is one thing.
Sanjit, if I could interrupt, I think we have 6 or 7 minutes. So just hold on. You have a concluding, just conclude. So we have Advocate Radha Rao.
Okay. Only to concluding, only one thing I would say. The judiciary is the third pillar of democracy. And if someone is tweeting without any basis, you are saying judges have destroyed. Where is the simple evidence there? And then in reply you say, I don't have evidence. What effect it will have on the nation?
Yeah,
that's it.
So we can move on to the next panelist. I'm very extremely sorry, we have paucity of time. So the Radha Rao, you can start.
Yeah. And open again another one.
See, I am concerned with the fact that that generally the citizen has always been looking at the Supreme Court and the High Court as a matter of last resort. Normally I can hear people say, let us move the court, because people have little confidence in the executive and the legislature. So the Supreme Court is the final authority in which people have confidence. And this confidence must not in the least be adversely affected. If we lose faith in that, in the Supreme Court, then nothing is left. And that is what I would like to speak on. Not only must the Supreme Court do justice, but it must be seen that justice has been done. The question therefore is, do we see that justice has been done? I am not concerned with the judgment as such, because the Supreme Court, as we know, or any court, has a right to pass good or bad orders. But the Supreme Court being the final court, any order passed by it becomes the law, including a bad order. Now, therefore, it is of utmost importance that the Supreme Court must exercise absolute caution. Now, in this case, the major issue is, we all know that no one must be a judge in his own cause. And the trouble here is, we also know that there are judges who are fallible, who could be corrupt, sitting in the highest court. Now, in such circumstances, how do we take this judge to task? And that, I think, was the problem with Prashant Bhushan. Because if you lodge a complaint against a judge, we know what happened in the case which Raju has just now pointed out, when in Kolkata, the lady complained of sexual harassment by the justice. Now, the matter was referred to the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court itself, and a committee of the judges themselves went into it, and the lady refused to cooperate. Now, the court held that her complaint is frivolous. But she has been reinstated in the court. That's rather strange. Now, what my grievance is, that there must be an independent authority before which complaints against the judicial authorities must be lodged. Now, if there's no such complaint, then any one of us is bound to think what we want, because we have no redressal forum. Now, this much is evident from what the four judges of the Supreme Court said in addressing the press conference, and I will quote them extensively. Now, this is Justice Chalameshwar. It is with no pleasure in our hearts that we are compelled to take this decision to call for a press conference. Now, the judges call for a press conference, which is not much different from what Prashant Bhushan did. He went on a tweet. That is also a sort of press conference. But sometimes the administration of the Supreme Court is not in order, and many things which are less than desirable which have happened in the last few months, time and again, as senior judges of the court, we thought we had a responsibility to the institution and to the nation. We tried to collectively persuade the Chief Justice that certain things were not in order and therefore we could take remedial measures. Unfortunately, our efforts failed. And my dear friends, we are all, four of us, are convinced that unless the institution is preserved and it maintains its equanimity, the democracy will not survive in this country or any country. The survival of democracy, it is said, is the hallmark of a global democracy, is an independent and impartial judge. Judge is symbolic here. It is the institution judge. It is a statement, but judge is in the context means the judiciary. But since all of our efforts failed, even this morning on a particular issue, four of us went to meet the Honorable Chief Justice of India with a specific request, which we could not unfortunately convince him, and we were right, and the appropriate decision is to be taken. We could not convince him. Therefore, we are left with no choice except to communicate it to the nation that please take care of the institution and take care of the nation. Because we have heard a lot of wise men talking in the country earlier, I don't want another 20 years later, some very wise men in this country blame that Chalameshwar, Ranjan Gogoi, Madan Lokur, and Kurian Joseph sold their souls. Now, this is precisely what Prashant Bhushan seems to have done. He has felt the same thing as the judges of the Supreme Court, and he has gone out with a tweet. So if the Supreme Court were to pull up these four judges for having approached the press with their grievances, perhaps Prashant Bhushan would not have said what he said in the tweet. So therefore, you see, finally, as lawyers, as citizens, we go by the laws interpreted by the court. Now, there is nothing in the Act, in the Contempt of Court Act, to define what is scandalous. So there, unless we know what is scandalous, how do we criticize the judiciary? Some judge may feel A amounts to scandal. Someone will say it doesn't amount to scandal. So therefore, it is important that the law must be firm and capable of being interpreted and only of one interpretation. That is not the case with our Act. And what I'm shocked and surprised is to read in today's newspapers that the Bar Council of Maharashtra and Goa, of which all five of us on the panel are members, has unanimously decided. I won't mind the decision. A decision is bound to be there. It could go this way or that way. But never in my life have I come across where when there is a group of 30 lawyers, unanimous decisions are taken. It is shocking. As lawyers, we are supposed to confront. We are supposed to say one thing and another lawyer is supposed to oppose. How does the Bar Council come to a unanimous decision on such a critical issue? It shows that they have succumbed. I'm sorry to say that the body to which I am affiliated has succumbed. There should have been at least one lawyer there who should have raised his voice. Because in the court, the basic purpose of a lawyer is to have back the other side. How can the Bar Council of Maharashtra be unanimous? It's shocking. In fact, I would like to condemn the Bar Council of Maharashtra for a unanimous decision. I don't mind that decision at all. But the fact that unanimous, it shows that none of them applied their mind. If one were to apply his mind, he would find various aspects of it which would require to be considered. Nothing of that sort is done.
See, so this is the problem. Just 1 minute remaining. We have got 1 minute remaining for us to conclude.
Hold another session, Pritam.
Yeah, we can start another session. But we can see 1 minute.
No, essentially what happens is
the decision is not taken place.
We will continue. We have got 1 minute to go.
So what happens is as far as Prashant Bhushan's case is concerned, actually I welcome the decision, not because it is right or because it is wrong. Because I look upon it as an issue for us to take up. I look upon it as an opportunity, because unless there's a hero, unless there's a martyr, nothing moves. We all know that things are not right with the Supreme Court. Things are going wrong. And to that extent, I appreciate that the Supreme Court has convicted Prashant Bhushan. And that would give us a hero. That would give us a martyr. Because unless you have a hero or a martyr, no one rises up. And I do hope that Prashant Bhushan becomes everybody's hero in this country to fight for justice, to fight for the small man, which Prashant Bhushan has always been doing. So he's going to jail or being sentenced is a very little consequence. But the greater advantage may be that we can take that up as an issue.
Thank you. Advocate Sudhir, you have got just a few seconds to say thank you.